Welcome to Speechless. We're live from the SCC studios in White Bear Lake. Glad to have you here. Also live in St. Paul. Today's show, a lot of information to discuss. We have Minnesota being discussed in Congress today in a Senate hearing on immigration and terrorism. Interesting hearing. So we're going to play a couple clips from that. A lot of court cases to discuss that have come out over this last week that really, I kind of think, shake the foundation of what we used to be as a country and is helping to erode our liberties and our constitutional rights. But it's not always about the case that you hear about or that the Supreme Court makes a decision on. A lot of times it's about the cases they don't make decisions on, that they don't hear about, where an individual's rights get eroded. And we're going to talk about one such case that happened in Washington State, freedom of conscience argument. And then we're going to talk about the Whole Woman's Supreme Court decision and talk about what Clarence Thomas had to say about that, which basically says, struck down a Texas law, which said it constituted an undue burden to women to get an abortion, even though they still could, still freely accessible, even though it would make abortion safer. And the life of the woman safer, of course, not the child. The child's going to be dead. The court said, oh, this is too much a burden for women to bear. Somewhere that's in our Constitution, I guess. So, interesting. So we'll talk about that and tie that in with other cases that have recently come down. So, in Minnesota, a Senate hearing, which was chaired by Senator Ted Cruz, Minnesota came up in the discussion. And we're going to listen to a clip of a man that educates Congress and the legislature in the military on Islamic terror and Muslim terror and what they're doing. What the language is, what they try to, how they do things, what their philosophy is. So he's training and teaching people about how it works. But in that process, they also do investigations and try to uncover who these terrorist organizations are, where their money's coming from, who's supporting them. And then Keith Ellison's name gets brought up in that. And it got brought up in such a way that when we show our second clip, Senator Klobuchar comes in and says, Keith Ellison's a fantastic patriot, and then she drops Representative Tom Emmer's name, that they're joined together with the Somali caucus. And I'm going to explain to you what's really going on after we watch each video. So let's watch the first video.
Mr. Gobbins.
Thank you, Senator Cruz. I'm a national security consultant with a company called Understanding the Threat, or UTT. UTT is the only organization in America which trains law enforcement, intelligence professionals, military, and leaders on the threat from the global Islamic movement, the doctrine of jihadi groups, and how to identify, investigate, and dismantle them. At UTT, we hold the firm belief that in order to defeat the global Islamic movement, we must understand the enemy. U.S. military warfighting doctrine, specifically the Intelligence Preparation of the Battlefield Manual, states that war planners must begin all analysis of the enemy with who the enemy says they are and why they are fighting us. That becomes the basis for determining the enemy threat doctrine, which, in the case of jihadis, is Sharia. Universally, the enemy, jihadis, whether it's Al-Qaeda, ISIS, the Muslim Brotherhood, they all state that they are Muslims waging jihad in the cause of Allah to establish an Islamic state under Sharia. I'm going to discuss one jihadi group, the Muslim Brotherhood. Based on evidence entered into the largest terrorism financing and Hamas trial ever successfully prosecuted in U.S. history, and my own experience conducting undercover research with Hamas doing business as CARE, the Council on American Islamic Relations. The Holy Land Foundation trial was adjudicated in Dallas, Texas in 2008 and identified CARE as a member of the Muslim Brotherhood or the U.S. Muslim Brotherhood's Palestine Committee, which is Hamas, a designated foreign terrorist organization. The U.S. government identified Hamas as an outgrowth of the Muslim Brotherhood. Documents entered into evidence in the Holy Land Foundation trial also revealed that ISNA, the Islamic Society of North America, is a Muslim Brotherhood organization which financially supports Hamas, again, a designated terrorist organization. At the time, it was in indicted, the Holy Land Foundation was the largest Islamic charity in the United States and was convicted on 108 counts for funneling over $12 million to a foreign terrorist organization, which Hamas, which is the Palestinian branch of the Muslim Brotherhood. The Muslim Brotherhood creed states, quote, Allah is our goal, the Prophet is our guide, the Quran is our constitution, jihad is our way, and death for the glory of Allah is our greatest inspiration or ambition. The Muslim Brotherhood bylaws state, the Islamic nation must be fully prepared to fight the tyrants and the enemies of Allah as a prelude to establishing the Islamic State. Again, the Muslim Brotherhood agenda is no different than that of Al-Qaeda or ISIS. The Muslim Brotherhood logo, as Mr. Haney showed, has two swords cradling a Quran with a reference to ayah or verse 860 of the Quran, which states, against them make ready your strength to the utmost of your power, including steeds of war, to strike terror into the hearts of the enemies of Allah and your enemies. This verse is also referenced in the Al-Qaeda training manual, which was discovered in May 2000 by British investigators conducting a search of Al-Qaeda operative Anas Alibi. Now, during my time conducting undercover research as an intern for Hamas, both at CARE Maryland, Virginia in Herndon, Virginia, and CARE National in Washington, D.C., I preserved documents that revealed Hamas doing business as CARE conspired to cover up fraud committed by one of their immigration attorneys, discussed coordinating with bin Laden and his associates, placed staffers and interns inside congressional offices, conspired to influence Congress, specifically judiciary, intelligence, and homeland security committees, impacted congressional districts, tasking each Hamas chapter office with influencing at least two legislators, and ordering books from the Saudi embassy on the virtue of jihad and martyrdom. Worked with a Muslim law enforcement officer to influence a major terrorism investigation by accessing a classified federal police database and tipping off the suspect. And the current administration and the U.S. national security apparatus continues to use leaders of Muslim Brotherhood groups like ISNA, the Muslim Public Affairs Council, CARE, and others to provide direct input into American foreign policy and domestic counterterrorism strategies. One of the results of this situation is to order the removal of terms like jihad and sharia from our counterterrorism lexicon. I attended a convention in Columbus, Ohio in 2008 organized by Muslim Brotherhood group ISNA, and both the Department of Homeland Security and the Department of Justice Federal Bureau of Prisons had recruitment and outreach booths. Both Congressman Keith Ellison and Andre Carson spoke at the Muslim Brotherhood event, and I witnessed Imam Siraj Wahaj, who is a vocal advocate for the implementation of Sharia and an unindicted co-conspirator in the 1993 World Trade Center bombing, solicit donations for Hamas at CARE's annual banquet. Siraj Wahaj was the first imam to offer prayers in Congress. Often when understanding the threat offers training to federal, state, and local law enforcement, Muslim Brotherhood groups work to intimidate the hosts of the training venues into canceling the training by threatening them with ties or with cries of Islamophobia and racism. Documents entered into the evidence in the Holy Land Foundation trial entitled An Explanatory Memorandum outline the role of the Muslim Brotherhood in North America. Quote, The process of settlement is a civilization jihadist process, with all the word means. The Ikhwan must understand that their work in America is a kind of grand jihad in eliminating and destroying Western civilization from within and sabotaging its miserable house by their hands and the hands of the believers, so that it is eliminated and God's religion is made victorious over all other religions. According to our enemy, the global Islamic movement, made up of many groups including Al-Qaeda, ISIS, the Muslim Brotherhood, Tablighi Jamaat, Boko Haram, Hamas, Hezbollah, and many nation states including Pakistan, Iran, Saudi Arabia, and many others, they all seek to impose Sharia. It is the blueprint from which they create their warfighting strategies. From a U.S. warfighting perspective, that naturally makes Sharia the enemy threat doctrine and adherence to Sharia a direct threat to the Republic. Until American leaders and...
Yeah, well, that's a snippet of what he had to say there. It's disturbing, to say the least. And what is Keith Ellison's tie into all this? But as I've said before on this show, and he's reiterating what I've said before, this is about doctrine of the Muslim faith. And this is what they're promoting. And if you're a Muslim, a real Muslim, a normal Muslim, it's about the doctrine. Now, the normal Muslim is called a radical today, but a radical Muslim is actually the real Muslim. And what's interesting, how he said the words, the purpose of his group was to understand the enemy. Well, that's interesting because that ties in with Keith Ellison and Thomas Jefferson. Because what was happening at the Barbary Coast, from the halls of Montezuma to the shores of Tripoli, U.S. merchants were being hijacked, kidnapped, killed by, and or held for ransom by Muslims. $1 million ransoms back in 1776, 1780, were being paid to get Americans back. $1 million ransom. And Thomas Jefferson said, I got to figure out what's going on here. He went and got a Quran, read the Quran, read the writings of Muhammad, the Hijab, I pronounced that wrong, the Hadith, and he went and studied, and he said, oh, this is our enemy. And he went then and would not negotiate with them and fought back. And that's what the Marines were about, understanding the enemy. Okay, and that's what this group was about. So what did Keith Ellison do as a Muslim? He took that Quran and swore on the Quran to uphold the Constitution of the United States. That is a contradictory thing. It cannot. His oath was fake because his allegiance was to the Muslim faith and to the doctrine of the jihad. That's all it can be. Okay, so his goal then is to destroy, as he was saying, the goal of the Muslim Brotherhood in these groups is to destroy the United States from within. And they're well on their way to doing that. And so Keith Ellison was at a Muslim Brotherhood event where one of the guys there raising money for Hamas, for care that was going to the Hamas, was prayed there, or was raising money there, also said the first prayer, but was also indicted in the Trade Center bombing. So this is what's being said about Keith Ellison at the at Congress today. I mean, I've added more pieces to kind of tie it in together, but that's what the Islamic faith is about. Read Muhammad's words. What would Muhammad do? Actually, do a Google search. What would Muhammad do? See what comes up. But it also ties into Hillary, and when he was talking about getting staffers and interns in office and in congressional districts and gaining influence, Hillary's chief of staff person was a fundraiser for CARE. Her number one person that I forget her name, but she's in tow with Hillary all the time, is out running around there, a Muslim person. And of course, where is Hillary getting most of her money for that charitable foundation up in Canada? From the Muslim states. Okay, it's quite the connection going on. Well, so Amy Klobuchar is on this committee, and she hears Keith Ellison's name being tied into the terrorist organization, and she fires back. But you got to listen to closely what she's saying, and the distinction that she is making, and I'll tell you why she's wrong. Clinton's aide, Huma Abedin, been heavily tied into the email debacle that's going on. So Hillary's sending all our national intelligence to the Arab countries. Got a number one Arab supporter right on her staff. You should sleep well tonight. Okay, destroying us from within. All right, let's watch the video on Senator Klobuchar, see what she has to say about Keith Ellison, and then ties in Tom Emmer. But I think the...
holding this hearing, and thank you, Senator Coons. Thank you to our witnesses. This hits at home for me. We have the largest Somali population in the country. I was just went out to meet with our first ambassador in 25 years to Somalia, Ambassador Schwartz, a man who's been in foreign service for over 20 years and is taking on this difficult assignment, and understands that this is a balance. And the balance is going after terrorism and evil at its roots at places in places like Somalia, going after ISIS at its roots, and it's also going after extreme ideologies, Islamic extremism here at home. But in our community, we love our Somali community. Nearly 100,000 people. I have a full-time Somali outreach. He's now been elected to the school board. We have people who are running businesses, who are part of the fabric of life in our state. And I was the prosecutor managing an office of 400 people during 9/11, where the state where Massawi was captured. And so we get this balance, and we see it all the time. And I always figured my mission as a prosecutor was to convict the guilty and protect the innocent. And what I have seen, the change from 9/11, when the Bush U.S. attorney, Tom Heffelfinger, I went around to the mosque and assured people at the President Bush's direction that they would not be victims of hate crimes, that they would not be bullied, that they would we would stand up for them, and that was part of America. I've seen different rhetoric right now that is hurting those communities and not furthering justice. I met with some of our people from our Muslim community a few months ago at a mosque and heard the story of a family that had gone out for dinner. Their family, where their parents had experienced no discrimination before, they were simply having dinner with their two kids, and a man walked by and said, "You four go home. You go home to where you came from." And the little girl looked at her mom and said, "Mom, I don't want to go home. You said we could go out to dinner tonight. I want to eat dinner here. I don't want to eat dinner at home." Those were the innocent words of a child, because she only knows one home, and that is Minnesota. And she only knows one home, and that is the United States of America. So in a state where we've now had dozens of indictments against people who have been trying to go to join those evil terrorist organizations of Al-Shabaab and ISIS, where we have convicted people in just the past month, understanding how important this is, respecting our law enforcement, our FBI, our U.S. attorney appointed by this administration for their work, I still understand how we cannot indict an entire religion and an entire community because of the conduct of a few. So this is a balance. I guess my first question, and this was, I've heard that Congressman Ellison's name was raised. He is my congressman. He is a man of great patriotism. He is a man that is paired up with Tom Emmer, one of the most conservative members over in the House, who took Michelle Bachmann's seat to start the Somali caucus. The two of them have done that together because we don't see politics as getting in the way of not just the prosecution of criminals and evil, but also in the defense of Americans and innocent Americans. And I heard his name was raised, but I know that I want everyone on the panel to know that he has been an advocate for funding, as have I have been, as a Senator Franken, as have been many, to figure out how we can go after this and figure out when kids and young people, no parent want their kids to grow up to be a terrorist, are influenced by this, and how we can do a better job of identifying problems. And that's why the Homeland Security, I know Jay Johnson's going to be testifying here, we're going to ask him about this, that we're putting out some grants now from Homeland Security. We put something like $50 million in the last appropriations bill to try to go after this violent extremism. And I guess I'd ask you, Mr. German, first about how you think this could work and how this is part of the solution, in addition to the what I support is strong law enforcement, but this side of it too, to try to prevent these kids from being influenced in the first place.
Thank you for the question. And I've been fortunate enough to go to Minneapolis.
Wow. It's just amazing. It's a total bait and switch going on there. She talks about this balance. Okay, we're trying to balance the rights of the Muslim with the safety of the American people, getting the criminal while leaving the innocent, you know, to continue on. Why do we have to have this balance? Kind of the question is why. And I don't want to leave it at the Somalis. I mean, what about the Egyptians? What about the Saudi Arabians? What about the Pakistanis? You know, this is about an ideology, a doctrine that people hold. Okay? And instead of coming into our country and assimilating into our culture, they will not assimilate into our culture. They want us to be subordinated to the Sharia law. Okay? And that was totally different from previous immigrants. And so why are we having to do this balance? Why are they here? And if we understand why they're here, is because the United Nations says, you need to come here. Okay? And you need to take these people in, you know, and this is part of the reason why Brexit took place. Okay, the British people said enough. Okay, we don't want any more of this European Union to tell us what to do with immigration policy, to tell us a whole lot of issues, to fund somebody else's reckless spending at the hurt of our own country, but immigration was part of it, and that was a big reason for that vote to exit the European Union. So what we have now is Catholic Charities, which Tom Emmer's a Catholic, coming in, so there's a lot of groups here, also real estate developers, you know, financing, you know, the more people, the more building, the more money they make. The higher demand for property, real estate prices go up. This whole type of, you know, interrelationship is going on. But why not let these Somali people or refugees or other refugees, why don't we let Saudi Arabia take them or Egypt or carve out part of Somalia for them? Or why don't they go to Libya or Chad or any of these other Muslim countries. Why are we bringing them here? Because we need to understand we shouldn't be bringing them here because they will not assimilate. It's against their doctrine. Okay, and so Klobuchar talks about going to the mosque after 9/11 and assuring them, you know, we're going to make sure the innocent are safe and stuff. And it's a good thing to do, but the Muslim community is kind of laughing behind their back at her. I mean, she's a useful tool. They're kind of going, great, we can do all our destroying of America from the inside. We got you in our back pocket, not really knowing what our underlying goal is. Know your enemy, Senator Klobuchar. That would be my statement to you. You know your enemy. Don't, you know, sure, let's spend $50 million to stop this violent extremism. Well, why spend it at all? Why, don't bring the people here. Do the screening at the border. You know, do the screening you're supposed to do. And so she makes, so why do we give out these entitlements? We shouldn't be doing that. We shouldn't have to be doing that. Okay, find a safe country for them that's a Muslim country. Can that even happen? You know, what, Dubai, you know? Boy, there's a lot of money there. So then Senator Klobuchar talks about, you know, do we indict an entire religion based on the conduct of a few? Well, you indict the entire religion based on the words of Muhammad and the doctrine of the religion. And if people are doing what Muhammad tells them to do, you got to say, those are the good Muslims, okay? Those are the good Muslims that are performing jihad. And you want to whitewash it? Great. Well, then she calls Representative Keith Ellison a true patriot who, you know, swore on the Bible, or the Quran, to uphold the Constitution, which is totally oxymoron, and then ties in Tom Conservative, the most conservative, taking Michelle Bachmann's seat in the most conservative district. Well, guess what? That district got bamboozled because Tom Emmer, not a conservative, okay? Voted for Boehner, voted for all the spending bills, keeping the spending going wild, doesn't stand up, hasn't made his speeches about controlling spending, and then is starting this Somalia caucus. You know, well, did Tom Emmer join the Tea Party caucus? No, not as far as I understand. I'll stand corrected if he did. You know, so that's why that area, A.J. Kern is running for, against Tom Emmer for that Republican seat. And A.J. Kern's been on this show, but she understands the refugee crisis. She understands how it's hurting St. Cloud so badly. Not only the culture, the safety, the health, the financial structure in the area. And she understands the real estate connections that are going on there. So, you know, Senator Klobuchar tries to diffuse this crisis we have in the United States and around the world, and comes up with a story about a little girl being told by somebody, a family, you know, go home. And that's sad. It shouldn't be happening, okay? But Senator Klobuchar didn't talk about the people going to work and getting shot up and killed in the name of jihad. Normal Muslims, the ones actually following the faith, being rewarded in heaven. You know, in the Muslim faith, you got to kill to get into heaven. You had to become a martyr through killing others. where Christianity died to save sinners, laid down his life. Just a different mindset going on there. But other people going to work, getting their heads cut off. She didn't talk about that. Just a few people. Well, it happens a lot more. So let's get a good right policy up in the 6th District. People need to vote for A.J. Kern, and I think we'll have a better realistic and a better conversation going on than the deception that Senator Klobuchar is trying to accomplish there. All right, we have a call. So, we don't have a call. I was trying to finish my monologue and couldn't wait that long there. Okay. By the way, call in if you got a comment or question, 651-747-3838. If you don't want to call in, you can email me at speechlessmn@gmail.com. Also, you can watch past shows on youtube.com/speechlessmn. Okay, well, let's get down to some court cases here. And I'm going to start off with a court case that wasn't heard at the U.S. Supreme Court, a court case that should have been heard, that affects freedom of conscience, freedom of religion. So let's play the video on this from the Alliance Defending Freedom.
This whole case started in 2005 when Planned Parenthood and other pro-abortion groups got together and decided to launch a national campaign to force pharmacists to have to dispense abortifacients.
When this issue first came up, I didn't even know what Plan B was. It just wasn't even on my radar. I took a look at really what was this product about and what did it do, and realized that that's not a product that I could, in good conscience, sell.
When a customer comes to the counter and requests Plan B, if she's conceived, I'm essentially looking at two patients, the mother and her unborn child, and I'm being asked to sell her medication that will take the life of that unborn child. And I can't do that.
So at that point, our process was a process we've done forever and is a recognized process in not only this community, but the pharmacy business in general, and that's refer that customer to another pharmacy that has that product. There's over 30 pharmacies just in our local area that carry the product.
However, in 2007, when the board ruled that we had to dispense Plan B, pharmacists were no longer allowed to refer for religious reasons. We still can refer for all other reasons, multiple reasons, but not for religious reasons.
This meant either leaving the profession or leaving the state or something drastic, that the government was going to force me to stock and dispense a prescription against my judgment.
I remember being at trial and asking each of the pharmacy board's witnesses, there were over 11, asking them, is there any location in the entire state of Washington that's unable to access these drugs? And they would say no. And we would say, is there any drug in the state of Washington that patients are not able to access because of religious conviction? And they would say no. So they're admitting that this is completely unnecessary, yet we're willing to force pharmacies literally out of business and force pharmacists out of their profession because they might encounter a patient that requests this drug and they can get it down the street. They never would have thought they would be in the position that they're in, where they would have to take a stand and potentially lose their livelihoods. They ended up being in the crosshairs of really a political agenda that they knew nothing about, that they hadn't participated in. But when it came to their door, they knew what was right. They knew that they couldn't violate their conscience.
We're talking about our Constitution. We're talking about the freedoms that were guaranteed to us first by Christ, then our country and our state. We realized that it wasn't about us, but it really had far-reaching impact. And that's when we decided, yes, our country means enough to us, our God means enough to us, we're going to do this. We're going to get on the bandwagon and we're going to stand.
Yeah, and they did stand, except that the U.S. Supreme Court refused to hear their case. So even though they won in federal district court, they lost at the Ninth Circuit, no surprise, because it's a very liberal court, who have been overturned continually at the U.S. Supreme Court. And in order for a case to be heard at the U.S. Supreme Court, you need to have four of the justices. My understanding is for the justices to say, hey, we want to hear this case, and then it can get heard. With Scalia dying, there's really only three conservative justices. So the case is not heard, and what that means for these people in the Ninth Circuit, which covers California and that West Coast area, they have lost your freedom of conscience, your freedom of religion in that area. Now, it doesn't affect Minnesota. In our areas, if a case like it comes up again from some other areas, then the Supreme Court may take that up and then it may end up reversing that other decision. But as of right now, that's a non-decision by the U.S. Supreme Court also takes away your liberties too, and can do that. A tragedy to say the least for that family. Now, you know what they're going to do? They're going to follow their conscience. I still don't think that family will dispense the abortifacients. And it was interesting she said, when that mother comes into me and wants this plan B, I know she's pregnant. I know there's a child in there. And as a pharmacist, she needs to look out for the child too. And that pill will kill the child. That's what it will do. Okay? And so she has a conscious right to refuse. We've had that in our country forever. You got to understand this about the U.S. Supreme Court and any judge in any court. All they have to do is give a pretense to following the law. That's all they ever do. They can make whatever decision they want, and if there's no checks and balances on that, whether it's being overruled at a higher court or being impeached or being unelected, which can happen in about 33 states where judges are elected, there is that check and balance, and that's the way you can get rid of a judge, or you can write laws that overturn the judicial decisions or change constitutions. All those type of things can happen, but a judge in their own capacity just has to give a pretense. Okay, and right now on our court, because of the balance, the liberals are going to get their way. And it ends up basically being a prejudicial selection system based on the liberal philosophy of the Supreme Court. And it's discrimination just the same. They're discriminating based on what they want to see happen. So in the end, because the case doesn't get heard, in a sense, they're being denied a right to a fair trial. Because those nine justices are the brightest in our country. Okay. A little sarcasm there. Is that abusive, using sarcasm? I don't think so. It can be. But all right, in Minnesota, to see if our Constitution is making any sense or being followed by our Secretary of State, a lawsuit was filed against the Secretary of State and other election officials, Ramsey County, Joe Mansky, Hennepin County, Virginia Gelms, various election judges, have been sued. And what happened is the Minnesota government is allowing felons to vote. Okay? They're allowing felons to vote, which is against our Minnesota Constitution and the U.S. Constitution, by the way. Okay? And so the Minnesota Voters Alliance and Kurt Stansrud, a former state rep, sued Representative Simon, and it goes straight to the Supreme Court. And at the Supreme Court, you know, it doesn't go to the district court or whatever. And anyway, the Supreme Court came back with an order on this case, a timing order. So as it looks right now, the Supreme Court will hear this case. And it's a rare exception that a case goes straight to the Supreme Court and they do all the fact-finding and evidence. And here's the petition. This is just the petition. This is not the evidence. Okay, you know, some 100 pages. And they had over 6 gigabytes of evidence of felons voting, over 1,400 felons. These are the easy ones. These are the low-hanging fruit, you know, so much research to do that they found voting, and it could have been avoided. All right. So anyway, the Minnesota Supreme Court came back and said, all right, we'll give the Secretary of State 30 days to file. Let me see where it says that here. That on or before July 15th, respondents individually or jointly shall serve and file a memorandum that addresses whether this court's original jurisdiction is properly invoked. And that's one of the big issues. Does the court, Supreme Court, have jurisdiction, original jurisdiction? And whether, if so, whether respondents will assert any affirmative defenses to any of the claims asserted in the petition and the nature of those defenses. In other words, is there a reason that the Secretary of State's office has a positive defense, a legitimate legal reason to allow felons to vote? Okay. By the way, there are none. And if the court's jurisdiction is properly invoked, whether there are any factual disputes that require the appointment of a fact-finding referee and the nature of those disputes. And that's basically saying, all right, Secretary of State, are you going to agree to the facts, or do we have to have a referee go and look at the facts and settle the dispute before we look at it? And then the last issue, and based on the requirements for the orderly administration of election as it relates to voter eligibility, the last date for the final decision by our... if a referee should be appointed, a proposed schedule for the return of the referee's report and recommendations. So it's in progress. July 15th, we're going to hear what the Secretary of State has to say about this issue and then see what the schedule is the rest of the way. All right, we got a phone call here. So, caller, do you have a comment or question?
Jim Ginley.
Hey, how you doing?
Jim Ginley, good. Thanks for bringing this important court information to us on election fraud.
Yeah.
The issue I want to know is I seen they made a big deal out of a new Supreme Court appointment on the local news this week.
Oh yeah.
And do you have any background on that? Have you followed this judge to look at her judicial temperament and what kind of decisions she makes and anything?
Yeah,
anything to report? Yes.
I don't. I just heard about it yesterday and I forgot to follow up on that. you know, supposedly first Native American on the Supreme Court, United States Indian. So what difference, I mean, that really shouldn't make any difference, but because they're supposed to follow the Constitution. So I haven't heard anything. Have you heard anything?
No. One other thing I was interested in, how does this appointment process work? Because like you've talked about on your show, these positions should be elected, but they're virtually always appointed, except for a few exceptions.
Right.
And there's some sort of panel that's apparently, which claims to be non-political, which screens people and brings them down to three. Now, do you know anything? Does this panel have any transparency? Does it work in public? Does it make any audio recordings? Do you know anything about when it meets? What times it meets? Have you heard anything about how this panel that makes its decisions? Thank you.
The short answer is no. I don't have that. They do give a report on the final three judges that they qualify, but the governor doesn't have to appoint from those seats. Governor is more likely to appoint from those three judges that get approved by this committee of, I think it's of 34 people. But district court, I think at the district court level, the governor is more likely to go with that selection that they choose. However, you see, everything's political. There's no such thing as nonpartisan. So if you got this 34 group of people who is knowable, and I just haven't found out who they are or where they meet. Well, former Supreme Court Justice Kevin Magna, no. Oh, what was his name? Magnuson. He was Pawlenty's head guy in charge of this search in this committee, and they appointed himself to the Supreme Court. You know? So, it depends up to the makeup of the committee and who appoints the people to the committee. But then the governor doesn't have to follow it. So I will go, that will be a show. I will go and research that committee, try to get somebody on from the committee, and we'll discuss that. But good question.
Kinley, do you buy into any of this idea that there are actually professionals in government? I've seen that, on the news, that Bill Clinton met with the Attorney General, and they insinuated that the Attorney General of the United States would never discuss the indictment of Hillary Clinton with Bill Clinton. And then she made the comment that all the civil servants working the Attorney General office aren't political. They are work on just a non-political level. Now, you've always said everything is political. Do you believe that all these city managers, all these city attorneys, all these officials that have all these high salaries in the local, county, state, and United States government are nothing other than just common, everyday, run-of-the-mill politicians? Or is there some higher standard they follow, which they keep saying are professional, meaning non-political at all? Thank you.
Yeah, I don't think the word professional means non-political. It just means you get paid for doing a job, and supposedly you have some expertise and experience in it. But that's subjective, you know. So a lot of terms are used to, influence a person's thinking about other things and about a position or whatever. So a political, a professional at the city council level or full-time person that gets paid is a professional, okay, at any level. And, you know, you can be a professional burger flipper. And that's a good thing. It's a good thing to do. It's a good service. I certainly appreciate it. So can the philosophy of that burger flipper affect how well they do on their job? Absolutely. And how they do their job? Absolutely. But so will that affect the quality of the product and whether I or other people come back. And you got this situation, and thank you, caller, for calling. We got to move on here. We got a little bit of time left. The situation at North Heights Lutheran Church, the place falls apart. Thousands of people leave. And then finally the place shuts down. Well, new management comes in and takes over, and the place is thriving. The people that left, you know, that got outvoted because they didn't show up. Okay, well, then they came back and showed up and outvoted the other people and started the place up again and is running fine. Okay, well, at a city government level like Maplewood or the city of Grant, you know, very abusive places, not everybody there, but obviously the people in power being very abusive. Those are considered nonpartisan races, but they aren't. You know, they get endorsements, they get political party endorsements. And in the city of Maplewood, they have a different structure that if they fail, they just tax you more. And Maplewood's failing miserably. Okay, I mean, at least $2 million of failure. And they just raise your taxes. Instead of having this management change, they get to keep the same person there because, you know, the money can keep rolling in through charging you taxes. So it's a sad situation in these government cities that operate that way and really have no accountability because the people don't care, you know, because they're still voted in there. And other people then just have to move out, which a lot of people are doing in Maplewood. Okay. Whole Woman's Health decision by the U.S. Supreme Court. We got a couple minutes to go over it here. An undue burden. It was just really fascinating that the Texas law was struck down because an undue burden on somebody that wants an abortion. So what's going to happen here, this undue burden standard, this new issue of deciding a court case is really, as Clarence Thomas says, the undue burden standard, it was applied in a way that will surely mystify lower courts for year to come. It's going to mess up lower court ruling, you know, trying to figure out how to rule. Just like drunk driving search warrant on breath test or blood test. You know, police officers all over this country are trying to figure out, okay, how do we do this now? Instead of having a clear standard, they confuse the issue. So now they come up with this undue burden standard on getting abortion, something that is not in the Constitution. An undue burden issue is not in the Constitution. It's nowhere there. It is, evidently it is now. The other thing that Clarence Thomas says judges aren't medical experts, even if they try to appoint themselves as such. And this came from the Federalist newspaper, Federalist Organization. And here's what Thomas said. Moreover, by second-guessing medical evidence and making its own assessment of quality of care issues, the majority reappoints this court as the country's ex officio medical board, with powers to disapprove medical and operative practices and standards throughout the United States. And the majority seriously burdens states, which must guess at how much more compelling their interest must be to pass muster and what common sense inferences of an undue burden this court will identify next. In other words, Texas tried to make abortion safe. And by making sure that a doctor doing abortion had the right to go to a hospital to practice there, and so that if complications happen, which lots of complications happens in abortions, they can get to the hospital. Okay. So women can still have an abortion. It wasn't being restricted at all in that regards, except at who did the abortion. and that the facility had to be sanitary and meet some sanitary guidelines that your veterinarians have to meet, but you don't have to meet for abortions. Oh, we're not going to get through all these. This was the great quote, made-up rights don't trump those enumerated in the Constitution. The court has simultaneously transformed judicially created rights, like the right to abortion, into preferred constitutional rights, while disfavoring many of the rights actually enumerated in the Constitution, like freedom of religion. Okay, I'm sure that was a reference there, and Second Amendment rights. But our Constitution renounces the notion that some constitutional rights are more equal than others. A plaintiff either possesses the constitutional right he is asserting or not, and if not, the judiciary has no business creating ad hoc exceptions so that others can assert rights that seem especially important to vindicate. A law either infringes a constitutional right or not, there is no room for the judiciary to invent tolerable degrees of encroachment. And this is what's happening with the right of the press to film in a courtroom. The court is saying, well, the right of a public trial, the right of a fair trial, and the right of the press to film. Well, the right of a press to film could affect the right of a fair trial. Well, the answer is, if you have the right of the press to film, it is a fair trial. All right. People, if you don't stand up for other people's liberties, who's going to stand up for yours? And good men don't do nothing. God bless. Have a great week. Days go.